Hi, everybody. So this is our first live stream for the CalArts Extended Studies program with character animation. My name is Vivian Lee, and we are going to sit in on a story class with Mark Dindal as our guest speaker.
If we don't get to everybody, I will. Make sure that everybody just gets in there at one time. Particularly if you're struggling, you have to be able to figure it out. Okay, I'll just meet here on Sunday starting about 1 o'clock, and we'll figure out a sign-up sheet with Michael P. We'll figure out how to manage that. But Sunday starting at 1 o'clock, I'll be right here. Okay, without further ado, the one, the only, the greatest, Mark Dindal.
Tools you can use to take whatever you have and create a story. So I'm just going to go through a bunch of them. It's very interactive. You don't have to do anything to train or anything like that, so just have fun with it. And what we're going to start with is our three improv games that I learned from the Impro Theater, which is a place in Los Angeles that does these wonderful improv plays, complete plays. I mean, they're like 90 minutes. They began a Western for 90 minutes and did this wonderful story that had, you know, characters and wants and, you know, conflict and everything. I've seen them do a Stephen Sondheim musical improvised with about six songs that were just wonderful. So these games that we're going to play are sort of some foundational elements that they use to create their characters and stories. And it's a great way to start our evening. So I think if we can, you guys can stand up and around the room and just get like groups of five or six.
Wait, I want to see Night Jen do it.
That makes birthday cakes that are unusual, meaning they aren't the typical thing. It's not just, you know, the typical cake that's frosted with birthday candles. They make cakes out of different things that you would never expect, okay? So this is your first day on the job.
You have to come up with an idea for birthday cake that's very unusual, very atypical, that's just gonna be spectacular, okay?
Now, we're gonna do this two times. The first time that you do this, let me take one step back. This is going to illustrate the importance of teamwork, where you accept an idea and build on it, as opposed to saying, I don't like that. An integral
foundational element of improv is when you accept an idea and then you add on to it. And this is the yes and.
I'm sure sure a lot of you have heard about
yes,
this.
Yes.
So
yeah,
if
yeah.
Your helicopter is here. You accept the fact that you're Madam President, and you respond to me in some way. You could say, Mother, I know.
And I am now your mother. I said that with enthusiasm. I love to play the mother in this little improv. Okay? That's when it works well. But often, instead of yes and, you get ideas rejected.
And it usually comes in the form of, yeah, but, well, yeah, that's a good idea, but, and then they give some excuse, and then they offer some other idea. So the first time we do this unusual birthday cake company, what we're going to do, we'll demonstrate. So if I say, hey, I got this idea of birthday cake made with hamburger, and you go, yeah, but, and you give me some reason why that's not a good idea, and then you give me a suggestion. So let's try it. Oh, I got this great idea. Birthday cake made of hamburger.
Do you have to do the
you yeah. Say, yeah, but.
Yeah, but. I mean, that's not going to fly. Do you think people like that? They're more the German chocolate kind of.
So now you give me a suggestion. Why don't we make a cake out of.
Why don't we make a cake out of hammers and sawdust?
Yeah, but that's really probably hard to digest. So why don't we make it out of celery sticks?
Yeah, but. No, celery sticks, nobody likes
them. Okay, so when you have a circle, you have a line, you got to
make a circle. What you're going to do is go around a circle
with that very, what we just demonstrated. Go around, you're going to do it maybe two or three times. Somebody make a suggestion, do yeah, but, give a new suggestion, the next person says yeah, but, and do that. Get the feeling of what that feels like. And we're going to do it for about a couple minutes. Okay, begin.
That's okay, yeah, but not everyone is comfortable eating pussies. It could be made out of flour. Oh, sorry, I messed this up.
Rhinoceros to skydive out of a plane.
Yeah, but how would that rhinoceros land? I mean, it's pretty big. Do they make fish?
Hold on. How do we make a cake out of this?
How do we make a cake? Wait, yeah, it's but gonna be how like do we make a cake out of a rhinoceros? Yeah,
change. So first let me ask you, when you were going, yeah, but how does that make you feel? You offer solution and someone says, yeah, but, and you feel like what?
Trash.
Yeah.
What'd you say?
Trash. Yes. And you don't make any progress, right? You didn't come up with any one thing. There was just a bunch of ideas and nobody agreed, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so this time around, this is what we're going to do.
you're gonna, the first person will start, and then the next person, like I heard over here, let's make a cake out of bones. then as you go around the circle, the next person says, that's fantastic. And then we could add, and then you add something. And then the next person goes, oh my gosh, that's so brilliant. And you know what we then do? Let's make a layer out of it. Oh, I love that. And as you go around, do what I heard you do at the end when you said yes, and we could, I think you said yes, and we could feed it to our enemies. There you go. So now this time, go around, and once you go around a couple times, and just love the suggestion and add on to it. And everybody keep adding on to it. Nobody say no. Everybody say yes. Okay. All right. Begin.
Yeah. structure of a tooth, of a toothpaste swirl.
Oh.
And we dyed it red for the red switch using actual human gum blood.
Okay, break into pairs. I hope there's enough people.
Just two by two, pairs. Everybody got a partner?
Okay, everybody's got a partner? Okay, Robert and I are gonna illustrate what this game is. So another very basic principle of improv and of storytelling and brainstorming and really of life is listening. And when the improv teachers, Dan and Steven, came and taught us this game, they made the point that often when people are talking and somebody else is waiting to talk, they aren't really listening to you. They're just watching your face to see when your lips stop so that they can just say what they want to say. And that happens. To collaborate and to build on ideas, it's important to listen. So this is a game that really forces you to listen. And the way you play it is somebody just starts with anything. It doesn't have to be fancy at all. Whatever the last letter of the last word that they said, the other person has to use that letter as the first letter of the first word of what they said. So we'll demonstrate. So if I say to Robert, where did you walk your dog to? Oh, everywhere. Ew, it must have been very hot out last night. Totally, man. So then you just keep going. But you can see, all right? So it doesn't have to be a fancy story, but remember, take the last letter of the last word and add on to what they say. Don't come up with something new. You gotta keep a conversation going, all right? Okay? All right? Begin.
How's it going, Robert?
Oh,
you want to say hi to the live stream?
So tell me what was that like, just as you were doing it? What sort of reactions and thoughts did anybody have? Anything?
Awkward.
Awkward? Why?
Because the gap between what they said.
to think about what they just said, and obviously with the word, and you had to then respond. So you had to take time to think before you just...
Yeah. So you didn't find yourself just waiting
for his lips to stop, and then you said whatever you wanted to.
Right. Yeah. Anything else? Any other?
This game probably sucks if English isn't your first language.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought it was really fun because being like stuck with that letter, you had to really creatively come up with the next sentence, and sometimes it would just go places you didn't expect it to.
Yeah.
It was really fun.
Like it doesn't keep a riot.
Oh, let me ask. Let me back up to the last game because I forgot to ask you. So you had the experience of the yeah, but how is that different than the experience?
What did you notice was different when you said yes and were enthusiastic about it?
More fun,
more fun. What did you say?
Empowering.
Empowering.
You come up with more ideas.
Yeah.
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 Rather
than like that's a whole thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like being in traffic and having a stop sign every block, whereas
oh.
here it was green lights. So you were able to go and go faster.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I noticed because you were all into building your cake, but within about 20 seconds, the laughter went up significantly than the first time, where there was laughter because probably. But
what you just described, you can actually feel that energy. You can definitely feel it entering the story room that
Robert and I are familiar with over the years. When there's lots of no's,
it does
feel like stop and go at a stop sign. But when everybody's agreeing and enthusiastic, it felt like it felt in here. And then granted those could be ridiculous cakes, but those are unusual and I've never. Heard a cake like any before you came up with ever before.
So they're very creative. So that's good. Okay, we're going to do one more of these games. This is another one from the Impro Theater. And
it's called ACE, and ACE stands for Advance,
Color, and Emotion. And the way you play this game is
one person
begins
to tell a story. Then the listener
says advance if they want to know the next thing that happened in that story. If the
listener wants to hear a description about that moment you just said,
they say color. That means tell me what you saw, tell me what you heard, tell me, was it cold, was it night, was it day, just describe it. If they say
emotion, then that means they want to hear how you felt in the moment you just said.
I went for a walk in the woods yesterday. It was just a beautiful early summer day.
So you can do a short
phrase like that, and then I say color.
I could see all the colors of the different wildflowers, and I could smell the aroma of the different plants, and I could hear the stream somewhere in the distance in the background. Beautiful sound of the water rushing in the stream.
Emotion.
And I felt sad. I felt really sad that my dog wasn't there to share the moment.
So good. You start with,
I went for a walk, and you get color, and you start to hear emotion. So everybody understand? So
we're going to do it once where
there's a storyteller, and the person says advanced color, and then I'll say switch, and you switch places.
Get the experience of both of being on both sides of that. Okay, everybody got it? Any questions? All right.
Begin.
I was kind of scared. but I could never know that I was slow. So I was like,
look, what's good? I really needed to go to the bathroom.
And then I had to turn off my
Yes.
It kind of feels like you're going, like you're like walking in the dark a little bit, but like you're coming upon like new areas of light, and you're like just like keep swimming through it.
Yeah. And did you feel that as you were telling it, or as okay, so when they said advanced color emotion, that's how you felt?
It's like I'm like searching through it.
Uh huh.
Discovering.
So there were things. Were you telling a story that? And so there were, you were finding things that you didn't initially know would be there.
Yeah.
That's good. But did somebody else, anybody else? Any?
It was kind of cool, like, drawing from life experiences and real feelings to, like, be like, oh, you know, this is happening. But I actually did feel sad this one time because something good was happening. So it's like, oh, how does that actually feel?
So you told a story.
No, it was fictional.
It was fictional.
I just used their feelings.
Right. That's good. Uh-huh. And you?
I told a real story.
Yeah.
It was interesting because it made me think about things. Remember things about the moment that I wouldn't have thought of otherwise.
So did everybody have that feeling that there was much more there than you thought?
Yeah. And it pretty much did you start with something that
was more or less ordinary, not fantastical?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So when I...
Mine was turning fantastical, just to fill in the...
Yeah.
So when I was here for the Castle Dance thing, I think I mentioned
the idea of taking something ordinary and making it an extraordinary by adding your point of view. And this exercise is an example how something that could be considered ordinary or kind of straightforward can become more spectacular. There's more there than you ever thought when you give your point of view of what it looked like, what it smelled like, what it, you know, was cold, it was hot, whatever, and also your emotional reaction. So have any of you gone back to your elementary school as adults?
Yeah.
And it always looks
small.
So when you think, you know, you were 6 or 7 or however old you were, and you went there, And depending on, you know, if you were intimidated or you were worried about going, then I'm sure the room looked bigger, the teacher looked 9 feet tall, you know, the doors, everything was so heavy, the books, oh my gosh. And now as an adult, you don't have that emotional feeling, so it doesn't look that way. And what I think is really neat is when you tell a story, if you pick a point of view, let's say you're telling a story about grade school, you pick the point of view that you remember, then when you're drawing that grade school, you will just draw it bigger than it is. It doesn't have to be, you know, like just the subjective way a school looks. You could draw the ceiling higher, the teachers, you know, large and looming. And then the emotions that you felt, too, can be integrated in that. So that's how you can take something that could seem kind of ordinary and make it pretty spectacular. And the thing that to remember is that not one of you will have the same point of view on anything. So that makes everything you do potentially very unique. It can be really unique and separate from someone else. And that helps you stand out above the crowd. It doesn't just make you one of many. It makes you an individual. So in the spirit of that, we're going to do a drawing, have a fun drawing thing. And this is drawing like a kid. And I really love children's drawings, and I kept the drawings my two daughters did when they were very young in a binder. And I really just love them so much because kids draw very emotionally. And what their drawings might lack in my older daughter really loved my wife's thick black hair. So one time she was drawn on a, you know, sheet of paper, like, you know, regular sheet of paper, and there was a tiny little face in the middle with the two dot eyes and a little smile. And then she just started coloring, just putting the, you know, I think she had like a pencil or something, and she was just sitting there so intensely and smiling and just putting in this hair. And I was like, what are you drawing there? She said, I'm drawing mommy. And I said, is that mommy's hair? And she goes, I love mama's hair. For like 20 minutes, she just sat there and filled until the entire page was filled with thick, luxurious black hair, you know, like graphite all up and down her arm. But it was a picture that had a lot of emotion. When my younger daughter would draw the house, she loved the roses. So she would draw the house, but the roses would be like, 75 feet tall and huge. Kids will draw things if they're, you know, if they're shy or afraid at school. If they draw themselves at school, they might draw themselves in the corner with smaller arms or, you know, tinier legs, and it's a very vulnerable looking drawing. So that drawing really comes from who they are. It's their very unique point of view. So their color and emotion in their drawings is not tempered at all. So this we're going to try and access that and do a couple of things that might show you what your, you know, your true kind of inner artist is. So I kind of stumbled upon this. I love these drawings, and I thought, oh, I want to draw like a kid again. You know, you think of just, you got the drawing pad and the crayon, a little more, and you're just drawing something that you love. Now, when I first started doing it, because I've had so many years of formal training, it's almost like that part of got put away in a coat chest, and there's the, you know, the professional artist is front and center. So I almost had to dust it off and kind of activate it again, and I could actually feel like part of my brain sort of struggling to, you know, just have fun again. And what I ended up finding was really useful for myself is I just, you know, thought of like, I want to draw a dog, I love dogs, and I tried to just get into that place like a little kid and almost make myself, you know, draw with that kind of, you know, almost like act like a little kid. So I'll do a demonstration for you here, and you can kind of get an idea. See it up there? So I think about dog, and then, you know, not with this sort of coordination of an artist, just kind of sit there and almost with your body kind of really get into it like a kid. You know, they'll draw like this sometimes.
Yeah.
a dog bone in his duck dish. So what I want you to do is try that. Try and access that part of yourself. You can draw anything. It'd be a dog, a fish, flowers, whatever. Try and think of yourself back when you were about, 6 or 7 years old. Just attack it. All right? Anything. Don't worry about whether it's good or not.
This is too, this looks too nice. It's gotta be less. Okay, what else can I do? The sun.
I always like the sun in the corner.
Wow.
The drawings for a kid are really good.
Art school.
Put your body into it. You're like 7. You love this. I'm drawing a house. I love houses.
Oh my gosh,
it's lovely. Oh, here we go. There you found it.
My boyfriend has lots of hair.
Oh. That's good.
Dude, you should see my cat. That's what I was trying. Don't you love that rainbow?
There's no colors in that rainbow. It's not a rainbow.
I only have five. Ready? You're using technology. Yeah. I can have all the colors I want. Here,
yes.
And blue.
Was sort of a slow start, but then almost all of you almost transformed, and you know, some of you are holding pencil like this, but everybody, you could just feel you kind of accessing that place, which was good. Someone over here mentioned it was a little harder to start, or you were saying it's a little harder to cut. Did you feel like a part of your brain? Yeah. Okay, now what I want you to do is draw something else, but switch hands. Don't draw with your dominant hand. Use your left hand if you're left-handed. Okay? It doesn't have to be the same thing. Just draw something else. Just do it with that same attitude, that feeling you had that you were doing the last one. Draw with your, it can be anything, just draw with your opposite hand. If you're right-handed, draw with your left hand.
Mark Denzel, everybody.
Oh, this is your other hand? Oh, that's great. Oh, I like it. How your interesting detail there.
I used to spend hours drawing mouse houses, and I'm ridiculous.
You like your self-portrait.
And I'd like,
gotta get it in. Yeah, I think so fulfilled.
All right, now your mind is in a totally creative place. You drew like a kid, you drew with your left hand and accessed the other part of your brain. Is it exhausting? You kind of slide like,
no.
Oh. Pardon me? Keep going. Okay, well, we're going to do one more thing. Now what I want you to do, just you can pick something like, some rabbit, a bunny, whatever. Just pick either a person or an animal kind of thing. I want you to draw it first with, go back to your regular hand. Draw it like you would normally draw it, okay? Just draw that
like
same.
An artist?
Just let it, like you, yourself today as an artist, how you would draw it. Just a simple drawing, doesn't have to be too complicated.
And it's a what?
Pardon me?
It's a rabbit?
Oh, it doesn't have to be a rabbit, whatever you want.
Can it be a potato?
A potato, it should be a living. Like a character.
Well, I was gonna put sexy legs on it.
Oh, well then, that is
sexy legs.
Just like you would normally draw. Just like you would draw today. If somebody said, hey, draw me a picture of a sexy potato. This is how I would do it. Okay?
Yeah.
got something?
No.
Okay, another minute. did you forget it?
No, yeah. It's
totally
yeah.
It's
like.
Missiles
I think I felt at home.
Like an old friend.
That's true. I think that is.
Yeah.
I drew a long neck.
Okay. Got it?
Yeah.
Pretty much?
Yeah.
Ready, everyone? Okay, now this is what you're going to do. Now you're going to draw with your eyes closed, but not completely closed. And what I want you to do is, you can open your eyes just every so often, just to kind of, just see where your pen or pencil is, like if you want to put pupils in the eye or something like this. So I'll demonstrate for you. Mostly you're going to draw with your eyes closed, but you'll open them every so often just to place your pencil. So watch up on the screen. I'm going to draw, I'll draw like a lion. So I'm picturing a lion. In your case, you'll be picturing the thing that you drew. I'm picturing a lion, and I'm mostly going to drop my eyes closed. So it's going to have a big nose.
He's so cute. He's perfect.
Okay. Okay. Every once in a while, but picture the thing you just drew, and now draw it mostly with your eyes closed, just imagining how cool that drawing is going to be. Okay? Everybody understand? All right. Go for it. Redraw the thing you just drew, but with your eyes closed.
Featuring Felix the cat.
You want this drawing to capture the essence of the guitar. What you just did.
Are you closing your eyes?
Yeah. I haven't opened them yet.
Oh my god.
How is that?
Pretty good. Are your eyes closed?
Yeah.
This is Nai Chen. He's a really good artist.
Jerk. The beautiful jerk. I can see.
Great.
This is with his eyes closed. This is with his eyes closed. Close your eyes.
I did. It looks. Look at that.
That's great. Let's zoom in on it. Check her out. He goes something.
I have no shame.
Awesome.
Eyes open, eyes closed.
That's great. That's great. You're making a great face too. I saw when you're drawing. You're kind of like you're looking up like you're seeing it in your head.
Yeah.
Nice.
I see you.
What is this?
It's Aaron.
They look exactly the same. Eyes closed?
Yeah.
It's pretty good. Yeah. I was like, what?
You should draw with your eyes closed more often, Nora.
I know, right? It's a talent.
Looks so bad.
show me the brain. But as I walked around, what is exciting, what I discovered when I did this, and I saw it in all of your drawings, that when you shut your eyes, the drawing just had more life.
Yeah.
Now, it may not have been, you know, sometimes the eyes end up in the wrong place or whatever.
Somebody said my drawing was a hot mess, but I thought it was actually really cool in a very unique way. What I found happened was that when I thought about what I wanted to draw, the drawing had more life. It may not be perfectly in, you know, in proportion and stuff, but it had more life. And my theory, and I saw it in all of the drawings that you did, and my theory is that when you start to do a drawing, the older you get and the more drawings you do, there's a part of you that's just criticizing the drawing from the moment you put the first line down. And it
unfortunately it never goes away, I don't think. Right, Robert? You always have that. You face a piece of
blank paper and go, okay, this is the day everybody learns I can't really draw, no matter how many times you've done it. But I think that just comes with the sensitivity of being an artist. But what I found is when I close my eyes, I think it turns off that critic. It turns off the adult that sits there and goes, seriously, that's supposed to be a
bunny?
You know, that part that talks in your head that doesn't help. Once you turn that off and only open your eyes every once in a while just for placement, I think the little kid in you that you did with the first drawings, the non-dominant hand part of you that accesses your creativity, I think that takes charge, and that's why in every one of the ones I looked at, the one with the eyes closed just had this life to it that I thought was really spectacular.
So the way you can do this, let's say, okay, what's the practical application? So use it with your assignment. You got a person, place, or thing. Your person is your character. You want to come up with a character that's going to be unique and would be a character that really comes from you. Doesn't look like it's a copy of another character. These are one way in which you can design that character. Try drawing it like a little kid would. Google, let's say you got mermaid, and you Google children's drawings of mermaid, and there's a bunch of inspiration like that that can get you back to that place. Try drawing it like you would
like a kid. You mentioned that when you drew, I don't know if it was just horses, but on the mane you put lots of stripes so that you color each one individually.
That's a very unique thing.
You can try drawing it like a kid. Use your non-dominant hand. And then try this exercise where you draw it like you think and then shut your eyes and just let trust that inner artist knows what to do,
maybe a little bit better than when your eyes are open and your adult self is sitting there, you know, going, that's terrible, you know. Does anybody hear that voice in your head other than me?
Yeah, Robert? Well, you can, better to catch that, put that critical
voice aside as early as possible so that the real you gets a chance to just flourish. And then what you can do, especially, you know, with these ones with your eyes closed, put another sheet of paper over and maybe just correct, you know, just sort of do a little bit of correction so it isn't quite so funky, but it still has all of that life.
And now you've got something that's way more unique than it would have been
if you didn't access that part of your brain. Okay, anybody have any questions or any
thoughts when they were doing that? Were you having fun?
Okay, great. All right. We'll move on. This is another drawing one that's fun.
So let's say this is another way to push
in a direction that's more unique to you, okay? So what I want you to do, let me put this up. You can do, again, pick like a face or something. So let me show you what I did. So this little, let me put it a little bit higher. High enough? Okay, so here's this, and seriously, I just did this like in 3 seconds. So like, I'm gonna make a little kid with square head. So I just did that. Okay, that's the thought in my head, little kid with square head. So I just did a quick little sketch. So just think of something, some face, human or animal.
Just do it really quick. Don't stress out. Like, I want to draw a kid with a baseball hat. I want to draw a bunny with long ears. Just do it really super fast. 10 seconds. Everybody got it?
Yeah.
Okay, now look at your drawing, and I want you to exaggerate some aspect of it. So I'll show you what I did. On drawing two, I took this little kid, I thought, oh, I drew him with a higher head. Okay, I'm going to make the forehead higher, I'm going to push the features down, and maybe make the pupils a little bigger. Okay, so now do your second drawing of that same thing. And just exaggerate some aspect. Some aspect that, you know, you're like, oh, that's cool. I'm going to make that a little bit more pronounced. Okay, you got that? Okay, now look at that. Whatever you exaggerated, now just go, oh, I'm going to go for it. I'm just going to push that really far. So here's my last one, where I made the head bigger, the hair, made the eyes bigger. I put a little body on there just to accentuate, you know, large and small. So now do the same thing with your drawing. Whatever you emphasize, now emphasize that even more. Just be really bold. Doesn't matter if you go too far. Good. That's good to hear.
Gone too far.
Yeah.
Can you explain to us?
It's a bunny with really, really big ears.
So now, everybody, when you look at your first drawing, you look at your first drawing, you look at your third drawing, I pretty much saw a really big difference on everybody's, which is terrific. When you look at your first drawing, does your first drawing, like when I looked at this first drawing, and granted I didn't spend a lot of time on it, I thought, man, that first drawing's boring. That's so dull, it's not unique, it's not eh. And the third drawing, which, as you guys just did, took you all of like 5 minutes to push it into something more unique. But I think naturally, the more you draw like a kid, draw with your left hand, draw with your eyes closed, when you push it, more of what's unique to you is just going to naturally happen. And I think it's just a process that will happen more naturally the more you do it. So if you're trying to design a character and you want to make it unique, you can use these tools to get to there. Because everybody's third drawing, they were so unique. I thought they had so much character. I love how you took and pushed things really extreme. Not everybody always does that. Like your beard on your character got super extreme. This hat on this little boy is super tall. Was it the cheeks on yours?
Yeah.
It's just great.
Show me cheeks.
So great. Anybody got any questions on that? That's fun, right?
Well, what I was going to say
is not only can you do this with drawing, but you can do this with characters, you can do this with stories as well. And generally your first inclination will probably be a little more tame, you know, when you begin. Because you're just getting started and you're not letting yourself just be free. So let's just try this. We'll do this and we'll write it down as we say it here. So I'll give you an example. Let's say I write down bear, that's one. Then I get a little more specific and I go, oh, grizzly bear. That's a, okay, that's a little cooler than just a bear. And then I just go, hey, ghost of a grizzly bear. now I want to draw that. That sounds like a fun character that I want to draw. And then I could draw it like a little kid, draw it with my left hand, draw it with my eyes closed, push it three times, and in a matter of minutes, I went from just a bear, which could be kind of generic, to a ghost of a grizzly bear. And if I'm like, oh, that's cool, but I want to do something else, then I could do that same process again. So somebody just name a character.
Cat.
Batman.
A cat. Push it one
Bat
more.
Cat.
What did you say?
Bat
cat. Bat cat. Okay, be more specific and push it one more time in
baseball bat cat.
A baseball bat cat. There you go. Okay, give me another one. Just to start with a generic.
Elf.
Push it one.
Gangster elf.
A gangster elf. Wow. Okay. Now push gangster elf one more time extreme.
Single father gangster elf.
Oh. Now he's got humanity. Single father gangster elf.
Whoa. On a fixed income.
On a fixed income. Wow. Picture of an elf or a single father gangster elf on a fixed income. It's just so much better. And it took just minutes. All right? Now you could do that with a story too. So let's try this. Here, I'll start you off. Let's say that I'm going to start pretty generic. Once there was a bear who wanted
corn
to find honey. I'll start really, really basic. Okay, now push that one time. Once there was a bear who wanted to find honey, make it more specific.
Winnie the Pooh wanted to find honey.
Winnie the Pooh wanted to find honey. Great. Wanted to find honey. Now make it even more. Push it like you did the gangster elf.
Winnie the streets Pooh of Detroit. Wanted to find the ultimate trove of honey.
What did you say?
Winnie the Pooh wanted to find the ultimate trove of honey.
Ultimate trove of honey, and you said on the streets of Detroit. Yes. Ultimate trove on streets of Detroit. Again, look at you went.
I think that's Winnie the Pooh 5.
Yes.
So there you go from a bear wanted to find honey, which doesn't sound, I mean, it could be fine. Maybe that's a cute little children's book. It's still okay. But you got so specific in just a matter of moments to something very unique. I mean, I don't think there's a book out there of Winnie the Pooh looking for a trove of honey in the streets of Detroit. So that's another way you can use this. I just call this the push three times tool. And it's easy to remember. You do a drawing. Push it once, you know, look at some aspect of it, push it once, push it twice, and I call it push three times because if you don't see a big difference between the first one you did and the third one, then you should push it three times so you have four drawings. Did you have a question?
Oh, no.
Okay,
sorry.
That's all right. So what you want to get is some big difference. Now, you may do this and go, oh, you know, maybe I don't want it to be that. That's okay. Don't worry about that. You've discovered a direction that you don't want to go, but that's okay. Just do it again. It just doesn't take any time. Now, these things that I've shown you so far and the other ones I'll show you, I have gotten into the habit of doing it every morning. It's the first thing I do in the morning because you're
your brain is nice and fresh. You have been rested. It's probably a little closer to your, you know, true self because the day hasn't hammered you with worries and whatnot. And so I may just take a half an hour before I, you know, start doing stuff I have to do. And I'll just sit down and write cat and then push it one more time. Or do the drawings. And I don't necessarily have a story in mind. I'm just doing these to keep my brain at that place that I want it to be. Because as you found when you did the kid drawings and you got to that place, I think I heard someone over here say, oh, I want to go back and draw it that way. When I said do it, you know, draw it in your normal hand. So the idea of these things is to keep your brain in that place, just like an athlete trains and stretches to keep their body in that peak operating sort of mode. Okay? Anybody got any questions so far?
You all good?
All right. We'll try another thing here. This is a fun thing just to create a fun character. And this is just, I just call this an adjective plus a character type, okay? And the way you do this, you first write just some adjectives. So just throw out 5 adjectives.
Callous.
Callous, okay. What's another one?
Potato.
Pardon me?
That's not an adjective.
Oh, sorry.
Erudite. Erudite. Oh, how do you spell that?
Erudite. D-I-T-E.
Okay. You're such a potato idiot.
I like that idiot, right?
It could be potato-y. What's another one?
Starchy.
Pardon me?
Oblong.
Okay. 4th one?
Starchy.
Starchy. There you go. Now you got your potato. That's good.
Potato.
Yeah. So you were close. And one last one.
Prestigious.
Pardon me?
Prestigious.
Prestigious. Okay.
Oblong, starchy.
Prestigious. Is that how you spell it? No, no I. Well, you got it. Okay. Now. Yes. Well, callous,
unfeeling,
thick skin.
Yeah.
You know, if somebody's callous, they're sort of
cold,
like a
cold.
Curmudgeon banker.
Yeah, like, yeah. Nah, I don't care. Oh, my feet hurt. So what? You know, Scroogey. Scroogey. Okay, who would you expect to be Scal? Callous. Well, you said a banker, Scrooge. Okay, give me a character type who you would never expect to be callous. It's the opposite.
Big mouse.
Santa.
An elf.
Santa.
2-year-old.
Callous Santa. Erudite. Erudite. What is erudite?
That's like kind of learned or scholarly.
Learned, scholarly. Okay.
Hillbilly.
Who would you? An erudite hillbilly. Great.
I love that.
Erudite hillbilly. Oblong. What do you expect to be oblong?
What's oblong?
Eggplant.
Pardon me? Eggplant. Is usually oblong. Is that
oblong.
What somebody said?
Oh.
So what wouldn't be oblong?
A sphere.
Basketball.
A character.
Oh.
A dwarf.
An oblong dwarf.
Now let's think about starchy. If you use that word to describe a person,
a hippie,
they're kind of stiff.
Stiff. So a starchy hippie. You would not expect a hippie to be starchy, stiff. What were you gonna say? Pardon me? Did you say something? Oh, who did?
Gymnast.
A dancer.
Dancer. A gymnast. Yes. Starchy hippie. Dancer. Okay, and this last one, prestigious. Who would you not expect to be prestigious?
Dung beetle.
A prestigious dung beetle.
Yeah. Zombie.
What'd you say?
A zombie.
I like the dung beetle.
A dung beetle zombie.
Dung beetle zombie.
Prestigious dung beetle zombie.
There you go. So again, this is one of those exercises in a matter of minutes. With no intention, like you don't sit down and go, oh, I gotta come up with a super cool character, which just puts pressure on you, and then your critic will sit by your side and go, that's not good, and that person comes to the party and you don't want them there. You just write some adjectives. I actually took an old dictionary and just highlighted all the adjectives in it, so I can turn to any page and just pick them off, just at random. And then you think of the opposite of that, a character who would not have that quality, and you come up with, in a matter of moments, like 3 minutes ago, we didn't have an erudite hillbilly as a character. But an erudite hillbilly sounds like it could be the main character of like a Cartoon Network show, maybe. Or it could be this quirky character in a series of greeting cards that become super popular. The prestigious dung beetle zombie could have a whole chronicles of
comic book. Could be.
So I
love this idea for just how quickly you come up with something, and then it just
it's not like little sparks go off in my head,
and you know sometimes then I'll try and draw it, or I'll just quickly write out a quick story just to have it. Because you never know, you might not do anything with it there.
But maybe something that you discovered there, you'll find in a story you're working later, you'll go, oh, I got that cool erudite hippie idea, and I'm going to stick him in here, and that's who the callous Santa shows up, you know, and he catches them, or some kind of thing like that.
So that's just a really fun, quick way to come up with characters that you can use.
Now we're going to take that one step further, and there's a book. I got these. It's on my list there. It's called The Comic Toolbox, and it's by John Vorhaus. And this was actually the very first writing book I ever found, and I seriously just picked it off the shelf because it has a bright orange cover. And it caught my eye. And when I opened it up and read it before I bought it, he just writes things in very simple, plain English. He has a lot of ideas that are similar to these very simple things that you can try, and you don't really need to have taken, you know, a bunch of writing courses to understand what he's talking about. It's kind of made for just the everyday person to understand and quickly use. So in creating characters, he has what he calls a comic perspective. Then there's a tool of exaggeration and flaws and humanity. Ooh. So the way this works, let me look here. We'll start with, what was it? Oh, so we got a callous Santa. Really curmudgeonly Santa. Now by comic perspective, what he means is that the character's way of looking at things is substantially different than what you would consider normal. So what is Santa's normal way of looking at things?
Jolly.
Happy.
Joyous.
Hungry.
Hungry?
Yeah,
he likes cookies.
So that's the typical Santa. Now if we have callous Santa, he would be, what'd you say? Holding a grudge.
He would steal people's presents.
He'd
give you books.
So what kind of perspective on life would that guy have? Real Santa has a perspective of giving, bringing presents, bringing joy. This callous Santa's perspective.
He's been bittered by all of the naughty children in the world.
Okay, so his point of view is, you could say that he doesn't feel people deserve the joy. Okay, so his perspective is people, they're undeserving. Now you already answered the next question. Exaggeration is taking it to the extreme. So if you said, Cal Santa believes that people are undeserving of joy so much
that he steals people's
presents instead of leaving them. What else does Callous Santa do? Because he believes people are so undeserving so much that he... Pardon me?
He says he kills children.
Whoa!
It's callous. Seriously callous. Then he steals their presents. Then he does what?
Breaks the fridge.
He raids the fridge.
He's a jerk.
He what? He's a jerk. Anything else Calisanta
does? He steals their parents.
Steals their parents?
Nice.
He
puts cookie crumbs in their beds.
Cheese cars.
He what?
Cheese cars.
Cheese cars, yes.
Spills milk all over their
beds. Spills milk. Oh, and then it spoils?
Yeah.
Unplugged fridge. Gives recommendation on how you can be a better person with coal.
With coal?
Yeah, like he fills it with coal and then he puts a recommendation.
All right.
Rubs coal.
And then he rubs his coal dirty hands all over the wall. Okay, so his flaw, Calisanta's flaw is...
Well, it's his callousness.
His socks are three sizes too tight.
So we've exaggerated him to where he steals presents. Let's just write a few of these down.
He steals presents, and you said parents. And then he raids the refrigerator. his coal smeary hands. What was it? Oh, keys, cars, among, etc. So his flaw is that he is just, he just got such a sour attitude. Bitter, I think he said. So bitter. His flaws are bitterness and coldness. Okay, so, pardon me?
Okay, so we are low on battery, but we'll be back as soon as we can. So we'll try to get all your questions answered and resume as...
Yeah. Yeah, thank you guys for watching.
Yeah, bye.